Before starting, I would like to thank the Universidad Católica, because this is already my third talk within the last years in this the Lisbon area, and I would especially like to thank, of course, Isabella Capelua Gil for this really great cooperation, and thank you. Within the context of the summer school, I understand transvisuality both as a beyond of the visual and as an extension of its parameters and scope. Coming from a literary background, I'm interested in the relation of literature and the visual or audiovisual arts. Contrary to other talks, I will approach the visual from a literary perspective, with results both in a transvisual and a transliterary approach. My presentation originates from a research project entitled The Literariness of Media Art. The guiding concept is literariness as developed by Russian formalism. It refers to the specific qualities of literary language considered distinct from its habitualized everyday use, to describe how literary language deviates from conventionalized norms of everyday language. The formalists refer to several notions, among them the notion of ostranenie, making strange, or the notion of the complicating of form. Since literary and poetic elements play a significant role in many media artworks, literariness is advocated in this project as a device that is especially effective for analyzing art that features figurations of language. But it is by no means limited to it. Therefore, literariness is considered not only a literary, but I would say a transmedial and also a transvisual phenomenon. One of the aesthetic strategies that the project aims at analyzing is the adaptation of literary genres, so lyric poetry, drama, and prose in media artworks. Another strategy is the recourse and reference to pre-existing works, in this case, poems. There's always a reverberation, an echo, when I speak. Is it possible to take that off? Not for us? Okay, good. Another strategy the project is interested in is the recourse on concrete existing literature. In the second half of my talk, I will discuss two experimental single-channel video artworks that reflect and reference lyric poetry and its specific use of dense language. This reference will, of course, be by visual means within the context of this school. Before that, and as a basis for the analysis, I will first summarize genre features of poetry very briefly, and second and more explicitly, arguments of correspondence between poetry and film. From a historic perspective, genre theory has often claimed that poetry is the subjective genre, the genre of emotions, sentiments, and perception. Such a notion of poetry is largely a result of sentimentalism in the late 18th century and the following literary movements such as Romanticism. And it's also a result of the aesthetics theory and philosophy from German idealism onward. Two problems arise out of this understanding of lyric poetry. First, the lyrical subject and the factual author are often implicitly or explicitly equated. Second, the genre concept is limited to a lyricism, that is, to a certain contents and themes especially associated with personal emotions or, on the other hand, with nature perceived as sublime. As the literary scholar Dieter Burdorf has it, I quote, "The poem is understood as self-expression of the lyrical eye. The standard lyrical situation is the confrontation of the isolated poet subject with the superior and violent nature, a dissolving in the threshold between the subject and object of the atmosphere perceived." End of quote. Such a view on lyric poetry has been strongly influenced by the philosopher Hegel's genre definition, who claims that poetry does not represent the thing itself, but, as he has it, its inner vision and feeling. In other words, I quote again, the core of the poem is the imagining and sensing subject, integrating the whole world of objects and relations within itself and letting them be saturated with the interiority of a single consciousness, end of quote. So according to Hegel and several other thinkers of the early 19th century, it is the subject expressing itself in lyric, and therefore subjectivity as such, this is also a formula by Hegel, being the theme and content of this genre. Virginia Jackson frames this, what she calls a lyricization of poetry, as a historical transformation of many varied poetic genres or subgenres into the single abstraction of the post-romantic lyric. She argues that the majority of poems before and after the long 19th century do not fit into this rather narrow segment. The definition of a lyric as a short, non-narrative poem depicting something like the subjective experience of a speaker became the normative definition of poetry. And this tendency, I think, holds true up to this day, at least in for people who are not dealing with poetry on a professional level, artistic or scholarly level. So this rather narrow definition of poetry as the subjective genre. So now I'm coming to the next the theory part of my talk, when I will sketch the line of argument found throughout the 20th century and well into the 21st century of correlating or comparing experimental and avant-garde film with poetry. Experimental or avant-garde are terms usually applied when filmmakers, and I quote the scholars David Baldwell and Kristen Thomas, I quote, when filmmakers set out to create films that challenge normal notions of what a movie can show and how it can show, end of quote. And within the context of this talk, I will not discuss these genre terms. I will just use them as a heuristic formula. References to poetry with regard to avant-garde or experimental film are multifaceted and may be grouped under two headings. The first heading is something like aesthetic and formal correspondences, and the second heading would be comparable perceptive and articulatory levels. And there are several artists and scholars who have dealt with this topic, and this is a list of some of the most relevant ones I have been investigating already. I don't want to read this list. I will come back to many of them with quotations later. And I will now briefly outline theories that discuss film with regard to the aesthetics and formal features of poetry. And I have not introduced these features because it would be too long, but I think you will be able to guess or grasp it anyway. A much quoted text is the Russian formalist Viktor Slavsky's essay Poetry and Prose in Cinematography. He argues that there are films of prose and films of poetry. In the latter, formal elements based on composition dominate. In his view, a film without sujet is verse-like. There are two types of film, he says, the prosaic and the poetic, and these represent the two basic film genres. They are distinguished one from the other not by rhythm, or rather not by rhythm alone, but by the fact that in a poetic film, the technical formal features predominate over the semantic features. The composition is resolved by formal techniques rather than by semiotic methods. Plotless film is poetic film. According to Sklovsky, compositional means, for instance, parallelism, the recurrence of images, or the transformation of images into symbols, dominate in what he calls poetic formal resolution. He considers, for instance, a double exposure angle as a poetic device of formal rather than semantic derivation, as he says in this quote. The idea of distinguishing film genres according to the differentiation of prose and poetry can be found throughout the last century and also up to this day. The film historian P. Adam Sidney coined the term lyrical film and claims that the term film poem, prominent in the American avant-garde of the 1960s, carries the advantage of underlining a useful analogy of a certain type of film to the commercial narrative cinema that is in many ways, as he says, like that of poetry to fiction in our times. The popularity of analogizing film with lyric poetry lies in the effort to consider it as a sophisticated art and not merely entertainment. And this goal is especially evident, I read, in the film discourse of the 40s to the 60s. By emphasizing the relationship of unusual cinematic forms to poetry, and of course also to painting, collage, and music, Art in Cinema, Cinema 16, and the network of film societies that imitated them were implicitly arguing for the kind of attention and patience normally accorded to serious works of art. The avant-garde filmmaker Maya Deren foregrounds her understanding of poetic film based on a transmedial concept of poetry. According to her, poetry creates both in literary texts and in film a vertical structure. And that's a structure that confronts the horizontal linear order typical for drama or prose. And drama and prose are also attributes to be found in film discourse, so it's not only, she's not only referring to literature here. It's a very famous quote, I think, at least it's quoted again and again. It's from a discussion from the 1940s where she says that the distinction of poetry is its construction, what I mean by a poetic structure. And the poetry arises from the fact that, if you will, that it is a vertical investigation of a situation in what probes the ramifications of the moment, and it is concerned with its qualities and its depths, so that you have poetry concerned, in a sense, not what it is occurring, but with what it feels like or what it means. Poetry establishes what Deren calls a vertical composition, a textual montage, one in which juxtaposition leads to impressionistically attained insights. And several people have commented on this notion of the vertical film. For instance, Scott MacDonald, who commented as follows: horizontal being the forms of meaning made clear through the developing narrative of the work, vertical the multiple layers of meaning that accrue in forms of expression normally considered poetic. Or to refer to Sidney's recent summary, Deren, I quote, postulated two axes of temporality in cinema, the horizontal as the development of plot over sequential time, and the vertical or the exploration of the associations of a moment, end of quote. Stephanie Orphan has argued that there's a proximity between Deren's concept of vertical film and Roman Jakobson's famous principle of equivalence that he found in literary texts. According to Jakobson's formula, the principle of equivalence is projected, as he has it, from the vertical axis of selection onto the horizontal axis of combination whenever the poetic function dominates. Bordwell and Thompson use the term poetic film in a more general sense when claiming that the associational form is working somewhat as poetry does. They argue that it is comparable to the use of tropes in poetry. I quote, here the metaphorical implications that poetry conveys through language are presented in images and sounds, end of quote. The associational form is based on four main principles. Firstly, the principle of grouping images into distinct parts. Secondly, the principle of variation from part to part, for instance, by changing the pace. Thirdly, the repetition of certain motifs to reinforce associations. And fourthly, the fact that this form strongly invites interpretation and the assigning of general meaning to the film. To sum up, as has become obvious within this aesthetic debate on film and poetry, the reference to language is largely abandoned. The concept of the lyrical or the poetic refers neither to the act of writing poetry nor particular poetic texts, but refers to something like a human sensibility that can take a wide variety of forms. And it is often linked to the presentation of images and sound, mostly images but sound as well, and not to spoken or written texts. As mentioned earlier, poetry is frequently considered the subjective genre. When dealing with audiovisual arts, one has to face the fact that some authors and artists hand down this one-sided tradition. For instance, they refer to subjectivity as the alleged main feature of poetry when thinking about its attributed correspondence to avant-garde and experimental film. They argue for a comparison of the art forms with regard to perceptive and articulatory levels, and this is what I want to discuss now. Since the dimensions of perception and articulations are at times hard to separate, also in literature, they are presented together here, and it's kind of a mixed argument. Darren considers poetry like avant-garde film as an approach to experience, I have quoted that already, and argues that both arts are not dealing with what is occurring, but what it feels like or what it means. Correspondingly, Bordwell and Thompson claim that throughout the juxtaposition of loosely connected images, the poetic film suggests an emotion or a concept to the spectator. Pier Paolo Pasolini, both neo-avant-garde filmmaker and a writer, has published an influential essay entitled Il cinema del poesia, The Cinema of Poetry. And this is an essay that approaches cinema from the angle of semiotics. He uses the neologism im science, in Italian im segni, which means image science, it's an abbreviation of image science, and to describe, as he has it, the world of memory and of dreams. Even though im signs are not classified as linguistic signs, for instance, in a dictionary, they nevertheless constitute a common heritage, as Pasolini claims. The artistic film is grounded on a cinematographic language that he calls a visual language of poetry. And here's a quote. Oops. The linguistic archetypes of im signs are the images of memory and dream, that is, the images of communication with oneself. These archetypes consequently give an immediate basis of subjectivity to the im signs, the marks of belonging to the poetic. So that the tendency of the cinematic language should be expressly subjective and lyrical. Pasolini considers the cinematographic language of poetry as extremely subjective and contrasts it with a language of narrative prose more prominent in the history of cinema. Much in line with Pasolini, the filmmaker Andrei Tarkovsky also refers to the concept of poetic cinema, to the poetic as such, and repeatedly integrates concrete poems into his films. For him, the poetic is a leading aesthetic principle. When I speak of poetry, he remarks, I am not thinking of it as a genre. Poetry is an awareness of the world, a particular way of relating to reality. Tarkovsky therefore emphasizes the specific means of film to create poetic images with a peculiar, intense evidence. He emphatically speaks of the logic of poetry to be, perfectly appropriate to the potential of cinema as the most truthful and poetic of art forms. So he even claims cinema to be more poetic than poetry. The film scholar Daniel Kane emphasizes a tradition, as he calls it, a tradition of contemplative subjectivity, and this is a tradition that unites lyric poetry and poetic cinema. With this formula, he refers to Tom Gunning's seminal essay on the aesthetics of early avant-garde. According to Gunning, the early cinema was not dominated by the narrative impulse that later asserted its sway over the medium, but was guided by an aesthetics of attractions, of exhibitionism, and of a contact with the audience established through the actor's direct gaze into the camera, which later became a taboo. A critical point in this review of corresponding notions between poetry and film, introduced inter alia by Pasolini and taken up extensively in Sidney's recent monograph, The Cinema of Poetry from 2015, is the claim that a particular form of cinema makes intensive use of what they call free indirect discourse. Pasolini defines this device in that the author penetrates entirely into the spirit of his character. I'm quoting, sorry. The author penetrates entirely into the spirit of his character, of whom he thus adopts not only the psychology, but also the language. End of quote. In this view, the qualities of this free indirect subjective, it's also a term by Sidney, establish a technical language of poetry in that cinema is not of a linguistic nature, but of a stylistic one. And this tradition is characterized in Pasolini's essay by the following group of adjectives: oneric means dreamlike, barbaric, irregular, aggressive, visionary. It is rather problematic that we are here dealing, I think, with a narratological category used in the context of the lyric. In prose, free and direct discourse is a form of transposed figural speech, be it spoken or thought, and mostly in the third person singular preterite indicative, without verbum descendi. This type of narrative discourse evokes the impression that the character's words were immediately perceivable, or the character's thoughts. It is an intermediate narrative form oscillating between direct and indirect speech. Contrary to the modes of stream of consciousness and inner monologue, there is a fusion of the narrating subject and the experiencing character. Sidney rightly observes Pasolini's lack of differentiation between the modes of poetry and prose in this regard. Nevertheless, he picks up his notion, or Pasolini's notion, of the free indirect subjective as his guiding concept. He claims, for instance, that the filmic adaptation of this literary device into free indirect point of view fulfills several functions, namely that it accentuates the subjective point of view, that it enables an articulation of what he calls subjectivity. And it is, I quote, the site of the coalescence of autobiographical poetry with the perspective of the protagonist. So lots of different concepts are melting here. With these quotes in mind, it comes as no surprise that the filmmaker himself is considered as protagonist. Sidney extensively refers to the American experimental filmmaker Stan Brakhage when introducing this notion. And the lyrical film, he says, and I'm quoting from his older book because here the formula is more precise and more coherent, I thought. The lyrical film postulates the filmmaker behind the camera as the first person protagonist of the film. The images, and the problem I have with this is that you would not speak of a protagonist with regard to poetry, just at the side. So it's a melting of different poetological and literary theoretical topics. The images of the film are what he sees, filmed in such a way that we never forget his presence and we know how he is reacting to his vision. In the lyrical form, there is no longer a hero. Instead, the screen is filled with movement, and that movement, both of the camera and the screen, reverberates with the idea of a man looking. As viewers, we see this man's intense experience of seeing. At this point, an understanding of lyric poetry as the subjective genre coincides with the formal assumption of the genre's foregrounded self-reflexivity. According to Sidney, the audience, in the end of this quote, the audience sees the filmmaker's experience of seeing, which is one of many arguments for the heightened self-reflexivity and also partly opacity of the medium. I'm quoting once more Sidney. The filmmaker working in the lyrical mode affirms the actual flatness and whiteness of the screen, rejecting for the most part its traditional use as a window into illusion. Or as Pasolini puts it, making the camera felt and not concealing its presence. This device can also be thought of as an implicit reference to lyric poetry, where linguistic deviations or deformations are often accompanied by an increased self-referentiality, an attention to the act of uttering as well as to the material substance of language. These problematic but corresponding notions of subjectivity in avant-garde and experimental film, subjectivity in avant-garde and experimental film and in lyric poetry highlight the fact that we are dealing with a topic that may be relevant for media art as well. Even though the majority of works in the corpus of our research project that refer to lyric poetry by applying typical formal features do not activate categories such as subjectivity, sentiment, mood, atmosphere, and the like, they are relevant to a special segment of media art. These video works are classified by the artists, by critics, or archivists as video poems or lyrical fusions of images, music, and text. The works explore strategies of translating the aesthetics of poetry into audiovisual time-based art. They refer to a notion of poetry as subjective, expressing the sentiments, mood, and perceptions of a single perceptive and articulatory instance. And this instance is closely associated, if not equated, with the author or respectively the artist. Two of such works will be presented and discussed now. With a running time of 27 and a half minutes, the American artist Bill Seaman's Water Catalog is a rather long video poem. It consists of interwoven visual sequences on water, a vertical montage structure that tends towards the associational form. The work combines original songs and texts, a musical soundtrack, and image material. As artist performer, Seaman simultaneously fills the roles of poet, cameraman, musician, speaker, singer, and producer. And I will show three short excerpts now. Can we dim the light a little bit, please? You can leave the light off because I have two more short sections.
Hear the voice. Make a war. Make light of war. A confused way when it is where the chimney. The wave was thinking back on the old days. It was reflecting on its past. It left a residue soaked on the circuits of the sound. Corroded the wires. Disrupted the current. State, simulating blue, black, and white.
The soundtrack remains quite similar throughout the piece. It is synthesizer music grounded by beats, at times with stronger rhythm, with knocking or with the foregrounding of synthetic string instruments. The visual aesthetics is vaguely reminiscent of music clips video clips. The contemplative black and white images show many variations of water in its natural surroundings or in its domesticized forms. The viewer can observe the element during different times of day and the four seasons in its different aggregate states, still and flowing as a river, contemplative in a quiet lake, wild the ocean shoreline, as stream and smoke coming out of a factory chimney, for instance, as snow and ice. Mostly, however, Seemann presents the element as a shiny, impermeable surface, evoking associations of a mirror on the one hand or of a heavy and potent matter on the other. The leading aesthetic idea of this video poem seems to be movement, corresponding to Sidney's characterization of the lyrical film, or rather transformation, alluding to the famous saying, you can never step into the river twice, the same river twice, attributed to the pre-Socratic philosopher Heraclitus. Significantly, the water often flows from the right to the left side of the frame, inverting the standard direction of movement in both still and moving images. The trope of water vaguely alludes to certain emotional, psychological, or physical states, such as easiness and flow, or stillness and freezing. The video contains four actual poems written by Seemann entitled The Wake, Make Light of Water, The Glass-Bottom Boat Crew, and The Fireman. Seemann presents each of the four poetic texts in a different manner. The first is sung in a high pitch, the second is spoken in different tones of voice, like a dialogue and in a Sprechgesang. Between the second and the third poem, there's a long interval without text, partly accompanied by a humming voice and spherical trance-like sounds. The third poem quoted here is spoken in a highly rhythmical manner. It was also part of what you just saw and heard. A highly rhythmical manner with vague allusions to rap music. And since it is spoken twice, it's also creating a sort of iteration or refrain with shorter lines that contain assonances, dissonant rhyme, and wordplay. The fourth poem is sung again and corresponding in its articulatory mode to the first, but with a stronger tendency towards sing-song. A lyricization is achieved in part through alliteration. For instance, one line reads, the fireman feels the force of the water, assonance, repletion, and rhyme. Mainly, however, it is achieved, I think, through Seemann's use of his voice, which at times sounds as if he is enduring suffering. It is very passionate, it's even melodramatic, so it's a little bit like the singing of a monk or another kind of singer in church. This specific presentation mode, as well as the music itself, are reminiscent of the musical genre of dark wave, which was popular in the early 80s, with its undertones of melancholy and sorrow. Without meter, but with highly irregular verse, Seemann's texts appear only partly as conventional poems. Their sense of literariness is established through artificial articulation in the combination of spherical music and poetic images. The images vary from concrete photographic precision to highly vague and floating views presented in slow motion and resembling abstract painting. Through visual editing, in particular slow motion, familiar images such as water dammed in a lock in the middle of the piece appear defamiliarized and aestheticized. It is as if the camera itself were painting and drawing. The camera angle is mostly objective, though at times it tends towards the subjective. A subjective perspective is suggested most notably in a long diffuse landscape, in long diffuse landscape shots taken through a rain-streaked opaque train window, when the camera itself is still and the movement is only external. And consequently, the free indirect point of view, according to Sydney, is not dominant here. It's a rather, the perception remains rather neutral throughout most parts of this piece. Seaman's texts and images are highly self-reflexive, dealing associatively with the trope of water and its uses, drinking, swimming, diving, water skiing, fishing, watering plants, walking in the rain, or extinguishing fire. With regard to the artist's name, this reflexivity takes, of course, another turn. The water catalogue, quote, explores the emergence of meaning within continuous new combinations of language, image, and sound, all offered multiple possibilities for interpretation, end of quote, as Sarah Tutten puts it. Seaman himself has termed this associational form a recombinant poetics. He claims to be interested, and I quote himself, in combinational structures when non-hierarchical relations between image, text, and sound or music can be explored by someone who is interacting and is also interested in how emergent meaning arises through this interaction. This aim is realized by combining visual, verbal, and other acoustic material. It is most evident on the visual level in the cross-cutting of new as well as iterated images, a device used to a heightened extent in the closing section of the piece that functions both as a climax and a form of visual refrain by repeating many previous images in an increased frequency of change. These rhythmically structured sequences create a visual rhyme. For instance, the image of a large stone falling into water and creating water rings is repeated again and again and edited in several match cuts with other round and moving objects. Both metaphorical and metonymical relations are established in this way. The second exemplary video poem to discuss is the Korean-American Sehung Cho's video Identical Time. And this 14-minute video, alternating between black and white and colored, as well as between clear and opaque or abstract images, Cho uses audiovisual means to explore the isolation and loneliness within an urban environment. The images are highly aesthetic, if not poetic, evoking sculptural shapes of light, movement, and color. At times a guitarist, at times a cellist, plays dramatic or melancholic solo tunes, creating a mood of loneliness and longing. And here I will just show one excerpt, a little longer excerpt from the middle of the piece. So it's 14 minutes, and I will show something in the middle. In this video poem, poetry is not spoken by an acousmatic voice. Viewers must read it silently. Compared to the vocalized text in the water catalog, this creates a much quieter and more meditative atmosphere. Cho has chosen a white computer-generated font to depict excerpts from Octavio Paz's long poem of the same name in the English translation, presenting it in single lines, indenting at the correct places and put in the position of subtitles. This translational presentation mode manipulates the reader so that he or she is unable to read at their pace or to go back and forth as one might do when reading a poem. Reading the verse instead of hearing them gives the text an internal character, as if it were an interior monologue. This technique foregrounds a subjective perspective, a contemplative subjectivity, to use Gunning's formula. The urban landscape turns into a projection screen for the subjective camera and the vague but somehow personalized subjectivity perceiving it. As in sentimental or romantic poetry, the environment functions as a kind of mirror of the subjective conscience, which is self-thematized through reflections on the subway windows. It is poetry understood as an awareness of the world, as Tarkovsky's words. Paz's poem, Il mismo tiempo, appears very much like traditional poetry, being highly pictorial and featuring a lyric persona, a first-person subject. Here is the excerpt that corresponds to the passage that I showed. This afternoon from the bridge I saw the sun enter the waves of the river. All was in flames, the house, the statues, the porticos burned. In the garden, feminine clusters of grapes, ingots of liquid light. The coolness of solar vessels, the poplars, a foliate of sparks, the water horizontal unmoving, beneath the flaming earth and skies, each drop of water a fixed eye, reality suspended on the stalk of time, words weightless as man is weighted. Is not beauty enough? I know nothing. I know what is too much, not what is enough. Correspondences between verse content and video images appear associatively. For instance, when the text thematizes porticos that burned, while the simultaneous visuals show the columns of a subway station in bright, shiny sunlight, increasingly turning into an intense red as the sequence proceeds. Through this associational dense composition, the aspect of memory and dream is foregrounded, what Pasolini termed the oniric quality of the subjective cinematography. This dimension of imagination is also dominant in the past poem, as the intense and visually stunning lines quoted, alluding to fire, water, and other natural elements, show. A self-reflexive and repetitive element is Cho's filming of the palm of his left hand while holding the camera in his right. Through this, the filmmaker shows himself as operating behind the camera and therefore as the invisible first-person protagonist of the film, as Sidney has it. In these experimental shots, where the presence of the filmmaker is underscored through his own body, both behind and in front of the camera, Cho's hand grasps into the air and seems to be searching for something. Iconographically, this refers back to the tradition of the self-portrait in painting, where the artist's hands are of importance both as tools of the manual process of art. Laura Marx speaks of haptic, tactile qualities of seeing foregrounded in Cho's identical time. According to Marx, haptic images, I quote, can give the impression of seeing for the first time, gradually discovering what is in the image rather than coming to the image already knowing what it is. And her formula, seeing for the first time, is a direct, maybe not conscious quote of the most famous Russian formalist article by Slavsky. Seeing for the first time is a form of de-automatization, and this is referenced here, I think. The perceptive aspect is dominant in certain sequences of this video poem, where the handheld camera is creating quick, irregular movements through pan shots and tilts, as if it were exploring the forms and materiality of the subway carriage. Cho shot the work in the New York City subways, or metro over the course of a year, reflecting the seasons and the cyclic change of day and night. The city appears nearly deserted, and the few remaining passengers seem isolated and lonely, which corresponds to the muteness of script. People are commuting, but not communicating. Cho's video poem is a reflection upon the fugacity of life as time is passing in these endless subway rides. Using the interior subway window as reflectors creates the appearance that the filming is done from outside the subway carriage into the interior, and you only realize that it's a projection or reflection because the script is inverted. By cross-fading passenger images inside the train with views through the windows, a general impression of being isolated from other human beings is created. Throughout the video poem, there's a self-thematizing of the window glass between the perceiving camera and the people, or the people and the landscape it is recording. The glass pane turns into a master trope of separation and distance. Identical time repeatedly works with blurred and aestheticized images of scratched subway windows. You see one here on the left, upper left, in the rain, in the sun, at morning, evening, night, in the underground and on railway tracks. The scratched glass features erased structures or graffiti patterns and corresponds visually to the simultaneous white words of the poem. The scratches refer to a non-readability of the environment, its fundamental opacity. With the aesthetic device of the scratched window, Cho may allude to Stan Brakhage's experimental films, such as Reflections on Black, where the artist scratched the film material itself, a device that Sidney characterizes as metaphor on vision. Or rather, as a metaphor on the negation of vision, one may say. It may be a reference also to the pure cinema movement in general and its avant-garde notion of filming as nothing but projected light. One is also reminded of a remark by Sidney quoted earlier that the filmmaker, I quote again, the filmmaker working in the lyrical mode affirms the actual flatness and whiteness of the screen, rejecting its use as a window into illusion. Identical time both highlights and negates the window effect of the actual subway windows, shifting between transparency and opacity. Not least, this continuous transition is a device of both thematizing and concealing the medium of the film camera. As emphasized in the Seaman analysis, this video also inverts the regular movement dynamics. The depicted subway continuously, or at least quite often, move from left to right, which is a visual negation of narrative sequence and of the experience of linear temporality. The title, Identical Time, therefore, alludes to a vertical temporality, of time being laminated, layered, with no continuous movement. As in Siemens, the water catalog shows identical time does not establish single moments of signification or a decipherable proposition. It creates a flow of moods, insights, and atmospheres, and is in this regard very close to a traditional notion of poetry. Thank you.